Right. Let's just reflect on this again. I cry aloud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out my complaint before Him. Before Him, I tell my trouble. Do you see that there's a whole bunch of stuff there that goes together? It's trouble, seeking mercy, and it's pouring out before the Lord. Yes?
Yes.
How many of you know trouble? How many of you know what it's like to experience trouble in your life?
Yes.
Don't know trouble. All right, cool. How many of you know what it's like to be in such a dire position? You want someone to just cut you a break. You know, you just want to be cut a break because it sucks.
Yeah.
You know, that's mercy, right? You just want to be cut a break somewhere, you know. I remember the days when I was in school. Not from my experience now, but from my classmates when they didn't do their homework. And you know when you look at your teacher with those eyes, as she comes around, I'm not sure what punishment is handed out now or in your school or whatever. And the teacher comes around and you're begging for mercy, you're just looking into her eyes, and you say, please ma'am, or please sir. And you start with a story, you know. The dog ate my homework. I don't know what stories are going around. You know, yeah, Lorenzo knows, because she's still there. Yeah, what complaints do you give, Lorenzo, for not doing your homework? She forgot her book at home, yes. And what do you hope will come of that? Some sort of mercy, yes. What is the punishment nowadays for not doing homework?
Detention.
You just have that, okay. Detention, like instantly. And what is detention, like Friday afternoon or something? Okay, like, okay, it's horrible, right? So now we come up with these stories, right? And we just want a bit of mercy. A lot of times it's not the truth. And I'm kind of wondering what percentage of the lies actually gets us out of detention. Because I think the I forgot my book at home will probably get us instantly in detention. I don't know. What's it like in your school? My teachers, they were like, they didn't blink. They're these little slips, and they dish out these slips, and you see those slips, you go weak. And then sometimes the most honest answer would be, I forgot to do it. And then she'd skip you. She'd skip you if you'd say, I forgot to do it, because that was the truth. But then you come and you say, oh man, my small brother got hold of it, and he put the crayons in it, and I didn't have time to redo it. Am I right?
No.
Okay, so some of us are getting away with it. But let's see how much longer. But my point of all of this being is that we all know what it's like to look out, to look up to someone and just say, have mercy on me. I know I didn't do what I should do. I know I haven't done what I could have or should have done. But have mercy on me. So what is that? That is actually asking somebody to cancel out your wrongs. Yes?
Yes.
That is asking somebody to cancel out your wrongs. It's like if you borrow money from somebody and you know you can't give it back. You'd hope for some mercy from that person that I don't have it now. I can't give it back to you. You would hope that that person doesn't come into your house and just start taking stuff to make up for that money, isn't it? You want that. You don't want the person to come in, take your kettle, take your pillow, take your socks to make up now for the money that you owe them. Am I right? So we all know what it's like to look for mercy. But then it gets better because it says, I pour out my complaints before Him and before the Lord, I tell my trouble. So in saying to the Lord, Lord, I have trouble. What are you doing? You're pouring it out before the Lord. You're not holding on to it. Because the troubles that we experience in our lives, guys, can so easily become hard so quickly. And hard towards all manner of people. Towards each other, towards our family. Yes, now we ask, you know, mommy for money for new shoes. Or there's a sale on jeans. Or whatever. And mom says, no, get your own job and whatever, whatever. And that kind of thing can very easily build up inside of us. Am I right? And the next time we ask, and it's the next issue, and it's the next issue. And we hold on to that. Next minute, we want to kill our mothers. We want to kill granny. We want to do, because we feel that bitterness inside of us. You see, those kinds of things are unhealthy things. Yes? It's unhealthy to hold a grudge. How many of you know that? Yes? You know, it's unhealthy to hold a grudge. Some people, or rather, let me say the world tells us that it's a good thing. Mustn't forgive them. What if it happens again? Yes? Have you heard that? You must protect yourself. And now we walk around with our grudges. And we walk around with our anger. And we walk around with our bitterness. Or worse still, we walk around with our self-pity. Because life has been so, so horrible towards us. And those things are not meant to be part of us. And anything that is not meant to be part of you will start causing a disruption in your system. Okay, let me, can I be a bit gross? Can I be gross? Will you allow me to, I need your permission. Can I be gross?
One moment.
Mazimba packet. It blocked your ears if you didn't say yes. Mazimba packet, you know the packet from chips. Right. Are we meant to eat that?
No.
You're supposed to eat the contents inside, right? Are you meant to eat the packet from Mazimba?
No.
No, I'm serious. Are we meant to eat it?
No.
Fine. We're not meant to eat it. We've established that. What will happen if you do eat it?
You'll die.
Will you die? Maybe not die. You'll get sick. How? Very sick. How?
Grossly so.
Won't digest. So what's gonna happen?
It's gonna get stuck in your food.
It's gonna get stuck. And what's gonna happen? Clementine? No pooing. Clementine said no pooing. Yes. So what's gonna happen? You're gonna eat food and drink and whatever. So this Mazimba packet is gonna cause a blockage in your intestines. And then after, it might still be okay, 2, 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, it might start hurting. Because there's no way, no place for the other stuff to go. Right? So it causes a blockage. And you're gonna start feeling some pains. And you're gonna start feeling some cramps. And depending on how big the Mazimba packet is. If you ate a big one from the 125 grams, it might be rough. But if you ate the 50 grams, you know, it might be a bit different. But the bottom line is it's gonna cause a blockage inside of you. Amen. And the more you eat, and you're gonna try and eat, right? You're gonna try and eat because you're gonna hope that the eating will push this thing down. But this thing is blocking your intestine. So what's gonna start happening? One of two things. And one is more gross than the other one. Thank you. You're gonna start vomiting. Because your body won't have any place they won't have any way to get rid of what you're putting inside of it. So your body's gonna force expel it. Now you don't have any nutrients in your body because the food that you've been eating has not gone anywhere because it's been blocked. Chances are you can get very thin. In addition to the stomach pains you have, you'll start vomiting, you're going to feel really, really weak. You might get other ailments now because your body's not getting nourishment. You might start getting sore throat, sore ears, who knows what other funny things will happen. Amen. Why? All because you consume something that you're not meant to consume. It's made you sick. It's blocked the flow inside of you. Amen.
Amen.
It's blocked the flow of the good stuff. Your body wants the water. Your body wants the bread. It wants the bananas. It wants all of that. But Moses is not here, so I can talk about bananas. Your body wants all of those things. But if there's a blockage inside, it's not going to be able to get what it needs.
Amen.
It needs the nourishment. But that's all because of this abnormality inside of you. So what is my point? My point is that we are not meant to be eating Mazimba packets of unforgiveness. We're not meant to be eating Mazimba packets of fear. We are not meant to be eating Mazimba packets of bitterness. We are not meant to be eating Mazimba packets of grudges. We are not meant to be eating Mazimba packets of low self-esteem. We are not meant to be eating Mazimba packets of worthlessness. Amen. Because when we consume those things and take them into us, they are not meant to be part of us. They will start causing blockages in our spirit and in our soul. If we do not pour it out. Pastor Tyrant from DGFC gave a message last year, I think it was, and it caused a lot of giggling and fun. Not a very nice message, similar to the grossness of where I'm going to with this. Do you know what an enema is?
Yes.
You know what an enema is? Pastor, will you explain to the people what an enema is?
When the doctor needs you to go for a surgical procedure or something and he needs to clear out your pipes to make sure that he can have you on the table and do whatever he needs to do, and there's not going to be an accident that'll cause a very unhealthy environment, if you get what I'm saying.
Which pipes?
Yes, yes, those pipes. Right? Then they give you some medicine. I won't explain that, but basically that'll just help you to clean everything out. Right? So there's nothing in the tummy, there's nothing in the intestine, so that it's all clean out, and then he can do his procedure or whatever needs to do, especially for medical procedures, as far as I know.
Yes, you get that, that's an enema. So they have to forcefully clean out everything. You know the old people used to, and I'm sorry, I have to be gross about this, because it's going to get to a point, okay. You know what the old people used to do? Maybe they still do. Is a device, you know it. Personal experience. They have this device, man. You can get it from most supermarkets. I think they still have it. But at least when I was growing up, it was in the small supermarkets. But it was on the shelf, the main shelf, you know, next to the Castor oil. So it's a device, it's like a rubber thing, man. It's like a rubber balloon. And on the other end of that balloon is a stick that sucks up water. Now what the old people do, they have no time to go to doctors and get jelly. Yeah, all those fans. Never no time for fans. They're like, hey, Rosa, fans. And then they take that stuff and they mix it with a mixture from what my granny used to, not do, she never did it to me, but really. Sunlight soap. Yes, am I right in the recipe? Sunlight soap and water, and sometimes they sprinkle some sugar in it. Am I right? Yes. I'm right with the recipe. So they put it in a dish, they got the green one, and when I say sunlight soap, I don't mean mushroom powder. I'm talking about the green one, the paw. The paw. Yeah, that one, the green paw. So they break it and it's hot water, because the water must now melt whatever's clogging. So they go and they mix it in, they sprinkle the sugar, and they and they fill this thing full of this liquid. And then you must go, so Lorenz is looking awkward. And then you must go and say, bend, and you go, and they do that. They still do it. Anyway, so they still do it, and then you do that, especially with children, you know, clogged up and whatever. And then apparently everything's supposed to come out, and that is also an enema. Close enough?
Yes,
what is my point of all of this? My point of all of this is that sometimes we need a spiritual enema.
Yes.
Pastor Ty brought this message last year called just that, a spiritual enema. Sometimes we've got to be forceful in the unclogging of our spiritual system. We've got to be forceful in the unclogging of our soul pathways. Because those things are going to make us sick. They're going to make us sick. If we have all kinds of obstructions in our souls and in our spirits, that we do not pour out to the Lord. And that is the secret. That is the secret to connecting. That is the secret to feeling well again. You know when we sing, it is well with my soul. You cannot sing it is well with my soul if there are blockages, if there are things that are keeping you back. A lot of people say, oh no, Pastor, I can't come to church. I'm going to sort myself out. How? How are you going to do that?
Amen.
When in the spirit, forgive me, Lord, you get an instant spiritual enema.
Yeah.
If you just pour out to the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
How are you going to fix yourself? I don't know. Pouring it out before the Lord in humility, in honesty.
Yes, come on.
In truth. Saying, Lord, this is what I'm struggling with. But we walk around all blocked up and angry at life because things are beginning to pain. And sometimes that spiritual and that soul pain even becomes a physical pain and even manifests in physical illness. It does. Because your body can't handle what's happening on the soul and on the spiritual level. And we're just angry. And everyone, we're just angry at life. We're angry at the dog. We're angry at the taxi. The dog is getting kicked. The taxi driver's to be honest. All because we don't want to be humble before the Lord and say, Lord, I poured out to you. Okay, but Pastor, I will tell you what's the other thing that people do. Amen.
You know, I think a big thing is that we have to be honest with the Lord. We have to be real. Because what we do is we hide. We hide this stuff. We feel ashamed of the ugly inside of ourselves. We feel ashamed of the stuff that's clogging. And we try to hide it. And then maybe it's so uncomfortable and our tummies are going bigger and bigger, but we just cover it with our jackets so that no one must see. No one must see that I'm actually struggling with this thing. Because what will they think of me? What will they say if they know that I struggle with this thing? You know, who cares? Who cares? Do you know that while you are worried about what other people think of you, they are worried about what you think of them?
Yes.
Do you know that? We can spend so much time and so much energy just wanting to save face with the world, just wanting to look pretty. Meanwhile, there's real stuff that we don't want to face and we don't want to work with and we don't want to pour out because we feel so ashamed or we feel guilty or we feel like we must hide, and then we keep on carrying those things. You know, the Lord knows those things already.
Yes,
I mean. The Lord knows it. But the Lord is not going to grab it, just take it out of you, because the Lord doesn't work like that. But the Lord knows it. Therefore, the Lord will speak to you and say, my child, that thing that you are holding on to, that thing that you're trying to hide and you think the whole world can't see it, it's starting to smell. And I know about it. And you know what? People around you can maybe start smelling it as well. And it's making you sick. And the Lord will say, my child, it's time to pour it out. It's time to get real. You know, sometimes people will talk to me and they say, hey, Pastor, I've got this problem and this problem. And then I ask them, is that really the problem or is there a deeper problem? Because sometimes even when we talk about our problems, we want to keep it on the surface. We want to keep it by the problems that still don't look too bad.
That's right, yes.
But sometimes those problems on the surface that don't look too bad, they're only symptoms of the deeper ones. And it's the deeper ones where you need to get to. And it's the deeper ones that you need to be honest enough.
Yes.
And brave enough. Say, Lord, I don't want these things clogging me anymore. I don't want these things being stuck. I don't want these things holding me back. Because I want the more of you. In the Lord, there's no condemnation, guys. It's Romans 8:1.
Yes, amen.
The Lord does not condemn you. The Lord will not look at you and say, sure, you did what? Ah, get away from me. The Lord will never, ever, ever do that. There's nothing you can do that will shock the Lord. There's nothing you can do that is so bad that the Lord will say, I've had enough.
Amen.
I'm turning my back on you now. But it's us who move away. It's us who turn away. It's us who take a step away from the Lord. True? Because we're trying to hide the ugly. In this season, I believe it is time for the ugliness to be exposed. It's time to let the chacha come out. Let it come out and then be over. You know when you're nauseous? Why are we talking gross things? I don't know. When you're nauseous, right? That sometimes if you can just vomit, you feel better. Am I right?
Yes.
You know, if your body is like, you ate something, some chicken or something that was just, you know, and it's just making you sick. If you can just be sick, then you feel better immediately.
Yes.
You know, and it's the same thing with these things, because I believe that a lot of us are still hanging on to soul things. And we think we know what the problem is, and we try to treat the problem, but whatever we do, the problem is not getting better, because I'm telling you now, that's not really the problem. The problem is deeper.
Hallelujah, come on.
Sometimes we think the problem is something here. I get angry at people, and I'm moody. You think that's the problem. Now you're trying to control yourself, to not get angry and moody. But meanwhile, you're carrying some deeper stuff. Meanwhile, you're carrying some rejection. Meanwhile, maybe you are carrying some fear. But it means that it can be deeper stuff And it's time that we get real with the Lord. Each one of us, you get real with the Lord. You can't come ask me what your problem is and then ask me to sort out your problem for you.
That's right. Yes.
I can't do it.
Amen.
But I can help you in the journey. But you need to be courageous enough, willing enough to go to the Lord and pour out those things and say, Lord, I'm going to keep on pouring until you tell me that this is the problem and it needs to go and it needs to go right now.
Amen.
You and the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You and the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You can have somebody who helps you on the journey. I can be there with you. I can talk with you. I can pray with you. I can help you. I can give you ideas. I can tell you, watch this thing on YouTube. Listen to that song. Read this book. Do that thing. Wada. I can tell you those things until I am blue, until I am green, until I what? But nothing is going to help you until you decide. This is the problem.
Yes.
I'm going to take responsibility to deal with this problem and deal with it now because I'm tired of this thing. Pastor, will you help me with this? Then I'll be there to support you. But you and the Lord, I can't do this. We can't do this for you. So wherever you are at this point, in all our lives, guys, the Lord is always moving. The Lord is always showing us stuff where there can be growth, where the Lord wants to heal us. If the Lord stops doing that, it means that you're perfect and that you're probably a couple of seconds from going to heaven. Okay? But this side of death will never be perfect. So there will always be something that the Lord wants to work on. So sometimes I talk to people and I say, sure, how's your prayer life going? How's it going? Are you reading the Word? And then I say, what are you and the Lord currently working on in your life?
Yes.
And a lot of people can't answer that. But all the time, you and the Lord should be working on something. Because we always need to go from glory to glory, right?
Amen.
We always need to work with the Lord. We always want to grow. We always want to develop. We always want to be trees that are flourishing. Nice leaves, nice fruit. That is this journey with Jesus. This is the journey with the Lord. But if you tell me, oh no, nothing, Pastor, now everything is fine, I'm cool, I'm you know, everything in my life is just amazing, then I'm going to say, wow, you must know. I'm currently working on stuff with the Lord. And I know when I look at myself and there's nothing that I'm working on with the Lord, I know that I've moved away from a close place with the Lord. Because then it means that I just carry on like there's nothing. Pastor Rosh?
Yes, Pastor, you spoke just now about the new thing. And as we know, we are entering it. There's so much newness that is coming over the next month. We know that the theme of conference this year is a new era of God's glory. We know that conference is held for the first time ever on spiritual new year, which means that we're going to transition from the old new year, from God's old calendar in terms of 5777 into 5778 and all of those kinds of things. Okay, so we're entering the new. Even 2017, as the secular calendar is beginning to wind down, you know, you can feel that year end is beginning to creep up, you know, and that's because spiritual year end is like a month away. But my point of all of this being, we're entering into a new era, and a new era also means that things have to be done in a new way. A new era also means that we have to sometimes maybe reapply or renew our understanding and our application of what it means to be a new creation. Because all of us, when we got baptized, or if we haven't been baptized yet, one of the things that we say to you is that be buried with Christ and arise with Him a new creation. But how many of us have forgotten that we are a new creation? With all of these things that we allow to swirl in our lives, all of the sickness and whatever, making us just feel so gross, how many of us have forgotten that we are indeed a new creation? But one that is getting work. Ephesians tells us, in Ephesians 2, 22, it says, and in Him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. Being built are the words that I want to focus on. You are being built. You're a new building, but the building is not complete yet, as Pastor Al says.
Yes.
You are being built. But what do a lot of us do? A lot of us have the foundation, okay? Now we're in God's family, we've been baptized, whatever, you know, your foundational start is. And then we go away. Can the foundation serve a purpose? If there's nothing, if there's no structure, if it's not a housing place or a safe place, can it do something? Just the foundation on the ground of cement. And what do a lot of people do? They come close to the Lord, or you know, they've just come to, and they've got this foundation, and then they're gone. You know what that is? You know what a foundation on its own like that is? A space taker.
Yes, that's right.
Nothing more, nothing less. If you've got a piece of concrete out there, that concrete was meant to be a hotel. It was meant to be a school. It was meant to be a house. It was meant to be a clinic. It was meant to be whatever. And now it's just concrete. It's just taking up space.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm sorry, I don't want to be a space taker. Because that's wasteful. It's a wasteful expenditure of God's efforts. If we don't come back time and again and allow the Lord to build.
Yes, that's good.
And allow the Lord to put the bricks. And allow the Lord to seal that little section by Spirit. And in the next time he puts more bricks and he seals it by Spirit. And so on and so on and so on. And then that building can actually serve a purpose. It can be utilized by somebody. It can be utilized for something. Maybe it's meant to be a clinic, and when I say clinic, I mean a spiritual clinic. Maybe you carry a gift of healing. And after allowing the Lord to build into you, after going back, after pouring out, after allowing the Lord to tap in some bricks in place and to seal it, then you can finally start healing people. I'm sorry, do you not agree with what I'm saying this morning?
Amen.
Then you can actually start moving into your gifts, because Holy Spirit is the deposit. What is the deposit? The deposit is the foundation.
Amen.
The book of Ephesians tells us, and I'll read it for you. You're going to be doing this in Nexus, by the way. We're starting a new study on Ephesians this week. Amen?
Amen.
Where's my Ephesians going to now?
Listen to this. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having believed, you were marked in him with the seal. The promised Holy Spirit. The deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption. Holy Spirit is your deposit. Holy Spirit is the outline of the building. Holy Spirit is the guarantee that a building is going to come up there. Amen.
Amen.
But we've got to go back. Because it is the Lord who builds. Amen?
Amen?
It is the Lord who builds. We've got Holy Spirit. We've been marked out. We've been outlined. And the Holy Spirit says, okay, this room is going to be for evangelizing. This room is going to be for healing people. This room is going to be for kindness. Where people are just going to... This room is going to be for generosity. This room is going to be for praying for people. Those are all our gifts. As Holy Spirit has marked them out in our lives, they're there. If you are a believer, if you have Holy Spirit, it means you have gifts.
Yes, amen. Yes.
Spiritual gifts.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Some of you know what they are, some of you don't know what they are. If you don't know what they are, stick around. We've got an assessment that we do to help identify your spiritual gifts. But the spiritual gifts mean nothing on a foundation of no walls, of no structure, of no ceiling, of a nothingness. Then it's a space taker. But we've got to be brave enough to go to the Lord in and as part of the new thing that the Lord is doing on the earth right now and say, Lord, I'm tired of just being a foundation. I'm tired of just being a space taker. I'm tired of just going through life and being all boring. A foundation is a boring thing. It's just, it's grey cement. It's just there. Like in the middle of, just, like, I mean, really, really, really now. I mean, kids can't play because if they fall, they'll get hurt. You know, there's nothing to it. I mean, it's not carpet, there's nothing. Are you getting my drift with this morning, family? So as we are going into the new year, allow yourself to become built up by the Lord.
Amen.
Not clogged up by yourself. Built up, that's good, eh?
Amen.
Don't allow yourself to be clogged up by yourself, but allow yourself to be built up by the Lord.
Yes.
That building, why? Because in that building resides the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
In that building resides the Lord. In that building resides potential. In that building resides destiny. In that building resides purpose.
Amen.
In that building resides fullness.
Amen.
In that building resides plans. In that building resides your future. But there will be none of that if there is no building. There will be none of that if we keep running away from the Lord just with the foundation.
Yeah.
None of those things will manifest inside of that building, which is you, if we keep running away from the Lord. For whatever reason, Pastor Al mentioned fear and shame and guilt and whatever. Rather allow the glory to expose what the glory needs to expose. Be truthful with the Lord. And say, Lord, here I am, build me up. I want to serve a purpose in this world. What is it that most people in South Africa want these days? It's land to build a house. That's all. People just want a house. Oh, a house. Just a decent house to just cement their dignity as a human being. Am I right? Most of our people in this country live in a shack. And forgive me if this is insensitive. I mean no insensitivity. But how many of us are living in a spiritual shack?
That's right.
How many of us are living in a spiritual shack that is going to fall over at any moment? Because we are not allowing the Lord to build us up the way the Lord intends, as mentioned in Ephesians 2:22. Where the Lord builds into us, because we are meant to be worth something. Your worth is in the building of who you are. And in this new era, as we are entering into this new era, family, I'm urging you, change your mindset. Do, like, literally do this. And switch over from just being a space taker to allowing the Lord to bring forth your worth. Don't hide behind the issues any longer.
Amen.
You think you're hiding behind the issues, but there's no wall. So the issues are actually there for a lot of people to see, by the way.
Yes.
Especially for the Lord. So stop hiding those issues. Surrender it all to the Lord. Allow the Lord to take away the pieces of tin of the shack. So you can start putting up walls that are strong. Walls that mean something. Walls that are solid. Aren't you tired? Aren't you tired? Aren't you tired of being flaky? Of being wishy-washy? Like I spoke a lot 2 weeks ago about James, and some people giggle nervously. And I said, I don't like people like that. It freaks my freak. It freaks my freak when people are wishy-washy. One day they're this, then they're that. You don't know where you stand with such people. Am I right?
Yes.
James says they're dangerous people. Dangerous people do not have a war. Dangerous people do not have the solidity of a structure that the Lord is calling us all to in the book of Ephesians. To come closer, to be brave enough, so that He can build us up.
Amen.
Do you know that you have a destiny? Do you know that you have a purpose? Do you know that God has mandated each one of you? Each one of you has a mandate. It's not just for fivefold. It's not just for church leaders. Each one of you has a mandate to bring heaven to earth every single day.
Amen.
Each one of you has a mandate to say, Lord, on earth as it is in heaven, your kingdom come, thy will be done.
Amen.
That is the mandate we have.
Amen.
And we have to accept our partnership with the Lord in this mandate.
Amen.
Thy will be done on earth as it is. Lord, what is your will for my life? But you know that you're not going to get to such a prayer and such a partnership if you are doing what? If you are hiding. If you are clogged up from eating spiritual and soul rubbish. Stop eating the rubbish. Stop holding. Just puke it out if you have to. Stop just being a space taker of cement. And allow the Lord to build you up. So that you can be solid for once in your life.
Amen.
Solid! Knowing that you have a purpose. Knowing where you're going. Knowing what's coming next. Knowing as we are transitioning, I'm urging you to adapt again. Adapt again. Adapt again. The mindset and the attitude of the new creation. Because the new creation says, Lord, here I am, a new foundation. Build me up.
Yes. Amen.
I give it all to you.
Yes.
I surrender my bad attitude.
Yes.
I surrender my stinking thinking.
Mm-hmm.
I surrender my anger. I surrender my fear. I surrender my jealousy. Whatever the case may be, surrender it all to the Lord. So at last, you can start finding some solidity in life. In life, guys, in general, not just here on a Sunday, in life.
Amen. Yes, amen. Yes. Amen.
Allow the Lord to build you up so you can take on again, I'll say it again, take on again, or renew rather, your identity of being a new creation in Christ.
Yes, Lord.
A new creation thinks new.
Yes, amen.
Pastor, I need to, I'm feeling it. A new creation thinks new. Am I right?
Amen.
A new creation speaks new. A new creation has a new attitude. A new creation has a new posture.
Come on.
A new creation has a new prayer life. A new creation worships differently. A new creation dances differently. Amen.
Amen.
Come on. New creations don't just sit like this because that's a new creation. I don't want to be it. Bless the Lord. Oh my soul. Oh Lord, I'm so tired and I'm so old. I can't even lift my hands in worship. This week was so hard, Lord. Oh, bless the Lord. You know if that happens again, I'm gonna come up to you, I'm gonna say, are you asleep or dead? Because the line is very fine here. I don't know what's happening. Are you asleep or are you dead? But I call the mortuary. Should we take you out right now? Because you are taking up space. Some of us can't even do this. Some of us are so full of ourselves. Listen, we're so full of that. Bless the Lord. Oh my soul. I don't know. You know, like, forget spiritual posture. My gosh. Some of us have got to do some push-ups. The natural posture. Just, oh, we're just sliding into a chair. Oh my word. What's happening to a young people? I'm not one of the oldest people in this room. And I'm not even 40. And some of us are like this. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Yes. Let your favorite soccer team play. Let your favorite rugby team play. Let them be. And I saw your, those people that were at my house last week, I saw how y'all can dance. Mimi, you can't hide it anymore. Hey, you guys missed out. I invited the whole church last week to our house, whoever was here. And we ended up dancing for hours and hours. Wasn't that fun the next day? When my neck was so, I think I blamed that on Waka Waka. I should have warmed up, I should have known better. What could have been that Macarena song? We went to the Macarena song. Yo. The next day, it wasn't Macarena, it was Macaroni mix. What is my point? My point is that we need to adapt the attitude of being new. We need to adapt the mindset of being new. And like I say, once we do that, our prayer lives will switch over. Our worship will switch over. We're going to shout it out from the mountaintops. Our postures will have a new walk. Oh my gosh. How long have since I've done it now? The world calls it walking. And what do I call it?
Yes.
You know it's when the Spirit is in you, man. You know it's when the anointing is on you. You just ask. Oh, I'm anointed and I know it. Oh my gosh. Who needs to walk so boringly? I mean, what's that about? I mean, like, oh my gosh, I'm walking. Why walk? When you can feel it.
Yes.
You can feel the Spirit upon
yes,
you.
God.
You know, you can just feel the vibe of Him. You feel that the kingdom is upon you today. Come on.
Yes.
But that is only for new creations.
Mm. Yes.
A old creations won't even know such things.
Amen.
Old creations will look like the old dry leaves outside right now. Wrinkled and crinkled and sliding down in their chair. Amen.
Amen.
Wrinkled and crinkled and sliding down in their chair, unable to even open their mouths. You know what I want to look like? The new buds that are coming out of the tree right now. Oh, those are green. And they're my attitude. You must look at the leaves, man, that are coming. Not the old guys, not those. I'm talking about the young ones that are coming out. They've got juice in them. They're like, oh, oh, spring. Here I am. Now they're like, oh, spring, hello. Oh, sunshine. Oh, spring. You know what I'm saying? That's what we need to be like. Not the prunes, yes. Was it last week I spoke of the prunes? Oh, that's just nasty. Dry those sugar up things. It's like we're 80 years old in the natural and in the spirit. My gosh. Hey, we need to get those new leaves. It's a new era.
Yes.
Attracts things. When the new comes out, when the new flowers come out, insects are drawn to it. Bees are drawn to it. Birds are drawn. Are you telling me that a bird is going to look at her for food under the gray old sugar up leaf there? No. The world is not coming to look at us if we're shriveled and dried up worse than a pack of prunes, pack of raisins. They're not going to see hope in us. Hey? Is the world going to see hope in us when we can't even lift our hands to the Lord? Bless the Lord, oh my soul. He's watching me. The Lord is watching me. That's who's watching me. How can you speak hope? How can you be a city on the hill? How can you go and shine light out there? How can you be the salt of the earth? When you are dried up old worm from last season. Oh, but there's a new breed. There's a new breed. There's some new leaves on the trees. There's some young worms that are coming. The eagles. Thank you, Jesus. But, that is of the new. That is of the new. A new way of thinking, a new attitude, a new way of seeing yourself, a new way of seeing your relationship with the Lord. Transition from hiding into allowing the Lord to expose you. Transition from clogging you, having yourself clogged up, to say, Lord, give me a spiritual enema right now. Your pastor is not the savior. The Lord is.
Yes.
Transition from seeing the pastor as this person who's just going to help and solve all your problems. Amen. How many of us have an attitude, yeah? We just see pastor, we've got any little issue. Can I have some silence here, please? Thank you. We just see people, any problem, whatever that we might have, and then we see the pastor's face, and all of a sudden, life sucks. I've got no money. Everyone hates me. How? So she got promoted, ne? She's Jesus now. Wow, when did that happen? Talk about a promotion. From the natural to the throne of God. Jeez, that must have been some CV that the Lord accepted it. How? From Pastor Liesl to Jesus. Sure, y'all know something I don't know. Amen. And this is our attitude that we have. But I'm telling you now, the expiry date of that attitude is coming close.
Yes.
And when something expires, it goes rotten. When something expires, it cannot be eaten. When something expires, it cannot be utilized. It is worthless.
Amen.
Your attitudes are going to expire very soon. If you're not quickly, say, yes, I want to be a new creation. I surrender my bad thinking. I surrender my bad attitude to the Lord. I want to be part of the new era. I don't want to be an old shriveled up worm outside. I want to be a young eagle.
Yes.
Fresh and full of energy. Hallelujah. Come on. New era. New way of doing things. New way that we see ourselves in the Lord. New way that we see ourselves in the Lord. Not ourselves through the eyes of the pastor. Not ourselves through the eyes of the leader. How we see ourselves through the eyes of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Nothing. Amen. Amen. Let's all stand, everyone. Streamers, I want to say, don't go away. The message might be able to join us in this time of ministry and just surrender to the Lord. If this message has touched you, even wherever you're watching from, in South Africa and around the world, I want to say to you, join us in the surrender, because there's a new era dawning on us. A new era that will expose the oldness. A new era that will expose us. We cannot fake being a new young eagle. You cannot fake that. That comes from hatching out of an egg. And that comes from hatching out of a spiritual egg. You cannot fake being a new bud on a tree. Amen?
Yeah.
That comes from surrendering to the Lord and saying, yes, Lord, let the winds of your spirit blow on me. Blow off the old things so that the new will come out. Yes, Lord, let the wind of your spirit blow over me so that that which needs to be removed before the spiritual springtime, let it be removed in Jesus' name. Yes, Lord, I want to be a new bud on the tree of life, for you are the tree of life. And I want to stay plugged in you with the purpose, because in time, Lord, I want to produce fruit after you. Spiritual fruit. I don't just want to be a foundation that is nothing, Lord. Like your word says in Ephesians 2:22, I want you to build me up, Lord. But I acknowledge that I need to surrender. I need to connect with you, Lord. I need to surrender. I need to give it all to you so that you can come and bring your ingredients into me. Lord, I'm tired of being full of myself. It has gotten me nowhere. Come and fill me up with your things, Lord. Come and fill me up with your spirit. Fill me up with your light. I surrender all to you. For Lord, I acknowledge that is the only way forward. To give myself away so that Jesus can be lifted up.
Yes.
To give myself away so that it is not I who lives, but Christ who lives in and through and around me. It's all about you, Jesus. I surrender it all to you, Lord. I surrender it all to you, Lord. I surrender, I surrender. Come on, just start saying that. I surrender, I surrender, I surrender. Why do you have to surrender? You and the Lord know, but start speaking it out. I surrender, I surrender, I surrender.